Get holiday scratch tickets from the South Dakota Lottery this year.
Everyone gets scratch tickets.
Good fun. Must be 18 to play. Please play responsibly.
Ho, 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 ho. Auto Value has once again teamed up with Toys for Tots to help deliver hope to less fortunate children this Christmas. Now through December 15th, you can drop off a new unwrapped toy or cash donation at any participating Auto Value parts store. Your toy or cash donation will not only help Santa, but also allow one more child to experience the magic of Christmas. On behalf of everyone at Auto Value and the North Pole, we thank you.
Collins Siding has been the region's premier window, siding, door, and gutter installation specialist since 1974. They use only the highest quality materials and never compromise on their workmanship. Collins Siding is licensed, bonded, and their estimates always include labor, materials, and applicable permits and taxes. Collins Siding has been providing top quality service and exceeding high standards for over 45 years, and you can find out how by visiting them at 2016 Cherry Avenue. Collins Siding, 2016 Cherry Avenue, Rapid City.
KIMM Rapid City and K294BT Rapid City, the Black Hills Sports Station, 106.7 FM and 1150 AM, Fox Sports Rapid City.
You need to know.
It's a short week for the San Francisco 49ers after their win yesterday against the Buccaneers. They now have to face the Seahawks on Thursday. Niners wide receiver Debo Samuel suffered a sprained MCL and high ankle sprain in that win against Tampa yesterday, with the Niners saying that Samuel is expected to return at some point this regular season. As for Brock Purdy, getting an MRI today on his injured oblique, he is considered day-to-day, according to the Niners. As for the Seahawks, they lost yesterday to the Panthers. Didn't have running back Kenneth Walker III. He was listed today as a limited participant on their estimated practice report, as he's dealing with a foot injury. Cowboys signed veteran free agent wide receiver T.Y. Hilton to a one-year deal. Patriots and Cardinals wrap up Week 14 tonight at 8:15 Eastern Time. A's traded catcher Sean Murphy to the Braves in a three-team trade that included the Brewers. I'm Dan.
It's time for South Dakota's Sports Talk Show. This is the Nate Brown Show, featuring live callers, live interviews, and thought-provoking sports talk. From the biggest national names to the hottest local stories, welcome to the Nate Brown Show on Fox Sports Rapid City. Here's your host, Nate Brown.
All right, here we go on a Monday. Boy, an interesting Monday, an interesting week setting up, huh? Heads up out there tonight, tomorrow, Wednesday, all sorts of stuff happening around the Black Hills. But we're back on a Monday, a Reaction Monday, South Dakota Sports Talk Show, the Nate Brown Show live. It's always a great day in the Black Hills. Remember that over the next few days. Hey, we need snow and moisture, right? So we're going to get it. Heads up, the Nate Brown Show brought to you in part by the Rehab Doctors. When it comes to non-operative care in the Black Hills for pain relief without surgery, see the Rehab Doctors, getting you up to speed, and they remind you, no referral necessary. So if you want pain relief without surgery, back pain, neck pain, leg pain, muscle pain, see the Rehab Doctors. I've been there myself. They get it done. TheRehabDoctors.com. For pain relief without surgery, take the first step to feeling better. Go to TheRehabDoctors.com. Getting us started on a Monday, South Dakota Sports Talk Show. A lot to get to. South Dakota State reaction. The Jackrabbits are in the FCS semifinals, hosting Montana State Saturday. I'm excited about it. It was a rematch of last year, but the Jacks had to go on the road to Bozeman. Got beat up a little bit, got beat on the road. Now they get him in Brookings. We'll talk to Sam Herter tonight, FCS national analyst for Hero Sports. He'll break down the FCS national semifinals. Jackrabbits have the toughest game. There's no doubt about that. They got Montana State, and you got the Bison up north. They get to face Incarnate Word, who upset Sacramento State. So it's looking like the Bison are going to get into this national title game. Imagine that. That's my take anyway. We'll get Sam Herter on from Hero Sports FCS Playoff Edition here on the Nate Brown Show. Then into the NFL with Will Raggetts, Vikings writer, Sports Illustrated. We'll talk to him straight ahead from the Twin Cities, SI.com. Will Raggetts on Vikings reaction. Parker Gabriel tonight from the Denver Post on the Broncos and an injury. of concern to Russell Wilson. Parker Gabriel on tap. Over the high school side, St. Thomas More boys basketball got the season started this last week. They're 3-0. What do the Cavaliers boys look like this season? Head coach Dave Hollenbeck live tonight. And Brian Noe kicks us off on a Monday, Week 14 NFL reaction. Fox Sports Radio national host on Countdown to Kickoff every Sunday morning. Brian Noe joins us live here on the Nate Brown Show. So we're ready. Great guest lineup, some good content, some questions of the day. You know that. We know the drill. Thought-provoking sports talk. Join the program if you want in tonight. 720-1067. We may have to make this puppy count. I mean, we're going to try and grind through this blizzard / snowstorm, whatever we got going. But you never know. You never know what's going to happen. So let's make it count. 720-1067, the studio line. You can join us tonight. And the Barron's Wilson text line, open and ready. Direct text the show, 720-1067. That's the Barron's Wilson text line for you. So off and running on a Monday, I want to hit on a couple of things here. So first I'll go to reaction to yesterday with the Vikings loss. So I was wrong. You know, I got to admit, I'm telling you, okay? A lot of times I'm wrong. Imagine that. Just ask my family. They would be able to fill you in. So I was wrong about the Vikings yesterday taking on the Lions. I thought, yeah, the Vikings are just better. They're going to have a good enough offense to just work through this defensive problem that they have going on. And I didn't think the Lions were as explosive. But the problem is the Vikings defense just can't stop a soul. I mean, the Vikings defense, I was talking about them here about 5 weeks ago. And it really got my attention on the Thanksgiving game against the Patriots. So I started talking about it about 5 weeks ago. Hey, this Vikings defense, I'm concerned. I went to the archives. I talked to the guests that cover the Vikings day in, day out. I said, maybe I don't want to make too much of it, but the Vikings defense, I'm concerned. But they're winning. They're getting by in the one-score games, and Kirk Cousins was 9-0 in the one-score games. And so everything's working out fine. And then I saw Mac Jones and the Patriots just light up the Vikes. And I thought, that's Mac Jones and the Pats. That's not an explosive offense. And they lit them up. Vikings still win it, so we're not too worried about it. And now the last couple of weeks, I'm looking at it saying, we got big problems. And I mean big problems. I looked at it a couple of weeks ago, and I started seeing the Vikings are struggling on defense so much that they're 32nd in total yards allowed. 32nd in total yards allowed. 32nd in passing yards allowed. There's 32 teams in the NFL. You guys know this. And so I'm looking at the Vikings yesterday, and I'm just telling you, it's now getting my attention in a big way that not only do the Vikings have kind of a struggles on defense, it may be one of the worst defensive teams you can get. It may be one of the worst defensive teams we've seen. Mike Zimmer did not have a good defense the last 2 years. So I don't want everybody to run to, well, we got rid of Mike Zimmer and now the defense is in shambles. We don't have that situation going on. Because Mike Zimmer's defense in 2020 and 2021, not good at all. I mean, not good at all. One of the bottom dwellers in defense. The issue with the Vikings is, you look at it, they made some moves up front. They got Za'Darius Smith, a nice addition. They haven't worked on, they haven't drafted well. They've missed in the secondary. And you got Harrison Smith back there. You got Patrick Peterson back there, both veterans who are on the older side of their careers in a big way. And then you've got the older guys that have lost a step. And you've got brand new guys that just aren't good enough. And I don't know if these brand new guys are going to ever be good enough. I'm sitting there looking at that Vikings game yesterday, and you add this thing up. The Vikings were 10-2 going into yesterday, and the situation is the Vikings have given up over 400 yards for five straight games. That's the first time that's ever happened in Vikings history. So when I say the Vikings defense concerned me 5 weeks ago, then I got really concerned in the Pats game. Now I'm looking at it saying this may be one of the worst defensive secondaries maybe ever for the Vikings. And if you look at it, giving up so many yards, a historic stretch, five straight, over 400+. And so now I look at it, I break down the stats. Here it is. So I was wrong, by the way. Vikings get 425 yards and a couple of touchdowns from Kirk Cousins. They get an unbelievable effort from Justin Jefferson. The Lions couldn't stop him. And the Vikings get all of those yards from Kirk, all the yards from Justin, enough points, but not enough with a terrible defense, not even an average defense. Here's the numbers. Vikings ranked today 27th in yards per rush allowed, 32nd in passing yards allowed, 32nd in total yards allowed. And then you go to the special teams. This isn't great, by the way. Vikings ranked 27th in field goal percentage. 27th in field goal percentage. So I'm looking at this whole scenario saying, really giving up a ton of yards, not just bending here. It's the floodgates. Giving up a ton of yards, giving up a ton of passing yards, giving up yards per carry, and now 27th in field goal percentage. That recipe is what? It's not going to be a deep playoff run recipe. I'm not saying the Vikings got lucky. I'm not one of those guys. You'll hear Vikings people say that, Vikings haters, essentially. And you'll hear them say that on Twitter and wherever, say, oh, this Vikings team was a fraud. I'm not saying they're a fraud. I'm telling you, the offense is good. The defense was good just enough earlier. And now you look at it, you say, you look at the whole recipe, you look at the whole body of work 14 weeks in, and you're 32nd in total yards allowed. That will kill you. That will take you out of any deep playoff run, right? That's the defeatist attitude that I have today. Not that the Vikings were frauds. I think the Vikings are fine at 10-3. They're going to win this division. They'll beat the Colts this week. They'll go divisional round. It'll be one of those things. They aren't going to be able to make the deep run. You just need an average defense to be in the mix. They have the last ranked defense in total yards allowed, passing yards allowed. Dead last from the Vikings. And that really reared its head yesterday, because you could say the Lions are better, and they are. They're playing better. Jared Goff's doing fine. But they're not going to be as explosive as some of the teams you'll see. It's the NFL. There's weird things that can happen in the playoffs. But if I'm betting today, I just think the Vikings have a good enough team. The coach is fine. A good enough offense to go divisional round. I don't think they'll get any further. Field goals to defensive secondary. It's just not good, and it's not Ed Donatell's entire fault. That's the D coordinator. He came over from the Broncos. Sorry about that, guys. But nonetheless, it's not his total fault. Mike Zimmer wouldn't have been able to save this day either. Kevin O'Connell's gotten more out of this team than Mike Zimmer ever did the last 2 years. So he's made the team that much better. He was asked today, are you going to change defensive play callers? Should we change the scheme here? He says he's not going to do that at this time. And if there is no tweak, scheme change, I don't know how much you can do. It's kind of like the Huskers in college. The Huskers' defense was really, really, really bad. They tweaked some things, then they were just kind of bad. They got better, but you have what you have out there. The Vikings have older veterans who've lost just a step, and rookie new guys that just aren't good enough. And it's been like that for a while, not building the secondary, missing on the draft, and that's the situation that's turned out. They can't quite turn the secondary around, and it's really killing them now in the Ed Donatell system. Mike Zimmer got a little bit more out of these guys, not much, the last 2 years. So this isn't we need Zimmer as a defensive coach. This is a organizational failure, not addressing it, and it'll hold them back. Cousins and the offense is fine, not only fine, but pretty darn good. And they would be good enough to go on a deep run. You'll never hear that from the national media. Everybody wants to say Cousins can't get it done. He would be able to get it done with Justin Jefferson, the best wide receiver in the league. The defensive secondary is 32nd, and it's going to kill the Vikes. I hate to say it. Listener text coming in, 720-1067, 720-1067. Let's see. If you told me the Vikings would go to the playoffs at the beginning of the year, I would have said no way, so I'll enjoy the ride. No, and I'm saying this. They're not frauds here. The Vikings are competitive, okay? Don't get this twisted. They're not going to just fold up shop and now they're frauds. They're a bad team. They're not a bad team. They have a bad piece, which is a major factor. They're going to give up a ton of yards, and it's just not going to be enough deep into the playoffs. A playoff team into the divisional round in that sense, can they get lucky? I doubt it, but the option's still there. The secondary's just really, really bad. And so the Vikings have gotten more out of the team. Kevin O'Connell has gotten more out of these guys than Zimmer has the last couple of years. Everything's pretty good. The organizational failure has been in the secondary, and it's been like that for a while. Thanks for calling today. You're live, and you go ahead.
Hey, Nate. How you doing, buddy?
Hey, I'm doing good, man. I'm doing good. What's up?
Well, I owe you another steak.
barely.
I mean, we were up by 20 at one point, but then the wheels kind of fell off.
You thought the Chiefs, you were smiling. I could tell, McJudgerson. You were smiling. Yeah. It was 27 to nothing, and you were just counting down the days for a steak.
I was. However, I don't know if I hear me out on this. Do I get a pass for Russ getting hurt and not playing?
No, not at all. If he would have played, we would have won. Yeah.
If Russ wasn't hurt.
Yeah. We would have won.
Yeah. Oh, sure. Okay. No. No, I'm kidding. I'll buy you a steak. But and then also Vikings, like I was texting you on Friday, like I am not confident in them whatsoever. Yeah, they can score some points, but if you can't stop anybody, good teams like Philly,
yes,
like Dallas, like we've pulled out some squeakers all year, but I mean, when you get up against some actual competition and you can't stop them, good luck.
I mean, it's disappointing because the Vikes are good in a lot of ways, and then they're dead last. You just can't be the worst. You can be average, and they'd be fine.
Right. Yeah, during the Bills game, the commentary, they were talking about there was something like 22 straight trips into the red zone they had allowed a touchdown or something. Like, your red zone defense cannot be that bad and be successful in the NFL. It's not going to happen.
Yeah, I know, man. It's a struggle. I'm telling you that right now.
Yeah.
I'll tell you that right
anyway.
Now. All right, buddy. Steak? That's two steaks. What are we going to do here? Yeah. Is it going to be a Deadwood trip? What are we going to do?
Yeah, I've asked you if you were going to be in Deadwood multiple times, and you always said, nope, I got family stuff. I don't know.
All that family stuff gets in the way, I'll tell you. All right, buddy. Hey,
right,
I got to capitalize on my bet win. You know that.
Oh, absolutely. Right. Absolutely. Maybe I'll buy you a gift certificate and come to the pizza party and give it to you.
I like it. All right.
All right, appreciate it. Have a good night, man.
Thanks for getting in. McJudgerson bet me last week. If you missed that on this show, McJudgerson, one of our favorite listeners there, bet me last week that the Chiefs would beat my Broncos by over 20. And I said, hang on a second. Don't disrespect a defensive team like the Broncos. They have a lot of pride, okay? And they almost pulled this thing off yesterday, by the way. I'm going to get into the Broncos here in a little bit. But to put a cap on the Vikings, Justin Jefferson's unbelievable. 46 career games, he has the most yards in NFL history. 46 career games, most receiving yards in NFL history. He's by Odell Beckham. He beats Randy Moss by 600. Okay? I mean, Randy Moss had the touchdowns going. Okay? He had the touchdowns in his first 46 career games. But Justin Jefferson, 4,516 yards, 23 TDs. When you look at 46 first career games, the most receiving yards for a wide receiver in NFL history. And it's one of those things the Vikings have to get this figured out. You've got to get some help. You've got to get it figured out in the secondary. They've missed on corners. They just haven't drafted well. And it's a glaring, glaring thing. And it's going to hold them back. A good team that's 10-3, they aren't frauds, but they aren't Super Bowl contenders, and that's the bad part for the Vikes. Let me get into the Broncos really quick here, 720-1067, okay? 720-1067. Into the Broncos, okay? Here's what I want to say. yesterday, the Broncos got down 27-0. Okay, maybe you were watching this. They got down 27-0, easily could have packed up shop. Travis Kelce of the Chiefs was smiling and laughing at the Broncos on the sideline. You know, the Chiefs, they got some juice, pretty cocky, right? Rightfully so. They've beat the Broncos 14 times in a row. And Travis Kelce was laughing at the Broncos on the sideline when they got up 27-0. And this is the thing about pro sports. Everybody forgets the motivational factor. All these guys are getting millions. You have to find the guys with the chip on the shoulder, the pride, the professionalism. And that's who I think the Broncos still have. They have leaders. They have pros. And the difference is they just have backups everywhere. So when it got 27-0, it was a struggle. The O-line looks like the worst in the league. Nobody could block run block. Nobody could pass block. I mean, it's a mess. Yet, the Broncos defense gets three picks on Showtime Mahomes, and then they aren't laughing all of a sudden. So you got to be careful in the NFL about laughing at teams, disrespecting teams. That was Travis Kelce over sitting on the sideline laughing. And then it looks like, well, see, these guys, they're a laughing stock. And the Broncos turn it around. They came up short, and it's never you're not trying to get close in this game. They lost again to the Chiefs. End of story. But you want to watch what I saw yesterday. I saw Russell Wilson be a competitor when everything's been going wrong, and we all know it. I mean, it's been bad. He hasn't played well. His O-line's god-awful. His running backs are gone. His wide receivers are here and there and everywhere. And this has been a mess. The coaching scheme and the coaching fit's an absolute terrible decision. And Russell Wilson's a competitor, and everybody in the national media loves picking on Russ. They love finding fault with him. They love saying he's hokey. They love saying he's a failure. And Russ Wilson, down 27-0, competed hard, 100 quarterback rating, 100 rating, 57 yards on the ground, threw three touchdowns, and I'm sitting here looking at it, and then he fights all the way down to the two-yard line and takes a terrible concussion because he's competing. Even for the fans and even for the folks that are booing him and laughing at him, I'll take his quote-unquote leadership any day over throwing players under the bus, pouting, acting like I'm better than everybody else. I'll take Russ Wilson's leadership over other guys I saw yesterday who lost 35-7 yelling at their teammates and still making excuses for how bad their offense is. Russell Wilson hasn't made excuses. I'll take the character and the leadership and the competitiveness. You get a new coach in, you get some players that actually are healthy, I don't think people will be laughing at the Broncos. Back with Brian Noe, Fox Sports Radio host, next.
Did you miss an interview or great segment on The Nate Brown Show? Just find The Nate Brown Show podcast and listen wherever you download your podcasts.
Have you hit a pothole or curb with your car? Does your vehicle need an adjustment or have an alignment, shock, or strut issue? Black Hills Tire is your one-stop shop for complete automotive service and repair in the Black Hills area. Trust your vehicle with no one else but Black Hills Tire. Contact Weston, Tenise, and the guys at Black Hills Tire, where honesty, reliability, and safety is their top priority. Black Hills Tire, voted the number one shop for automotive repair and brake repair and tire store in the Black Hills. Ask about their free pickup and delivery. Black Hills Tire, check them out online at blackhillstire.com.
Here's your Fox Sports Rapid City forecast. A blizzard warning begins at midnight tonight and continues until 5 a.m. Thursday morning. A winter storm warning begins at 2 a.m. early tomorrow morning and continues until 5 a.m. Thursday morning. Overcast tonight with snow likely. Lows around 18. North winds 15 to 20 miles per hour. Cloudy tomorrow. Snow likely 22. That's your forecast on the Black Hills Sports Station, Fox Sports Rapid City. Currently, it's 23.
At Black Hills Federal Credit Union, we are committed to improving the lives of our members and bettering our communities. As your community credit union, we're here to get to know you and your unique needs. From extended service hours to the newest technology, we have you covered. Stop by any location to get started or text or call 605-718-1818. BHFCU is member-owned, not-for-profit, and federally insured by the NCUA.
Hey, sports fans, it's Rob from the Firehouse Skybox. We are your headquarters for football this season. You want college football on Saturdays? Well, we have it. Join us for some great specials, and don't miss the games you want, from the Huskers to SDSU to USD. We have them all. And I know you want the NFL, so come down for $1 wing specials on Monday and Thursday nights. Then for the weekend, we'll have a great brunch buffet at the Skybox on Saturday and Sunday, with $4 Bloody Marys every Sunday. The Skybox is Rapid City's football headquarters. See you on game days at the Skybox, above the Firehouse, in downtown Rapid City.
Listen to what your friends and neighbors are saying about Anytime Auto Sales Service and Detail. Steve Borkert, Rapid City.
Been using Anytime Auto now for several years, actually. Heard their ads on the radio and thought I'd try them out. Turns out that it was one of the best decisions I've ever made. Came in for an oil change. Oil change was done easily and quickly. My son has had his oil changes done here also, but he also had shocks and struts put on. Great pricing, great work. Had new tires put on, and I got to tell you, the tires are amazing. And the pricing here is as good, if not better, than any place you're going to find in Rapid City. And again, everybody is very friendly and courteous and is above and beyond. We'll never take our vehicles anyplace else but Anytime Auto Sales.
There you have it. For the best in automotive sales and service, see Anytime Auto Sales Service and Detail. Corner of Highway 79 in East Minnesota.
Anytime Auto Sales.
All right, sports fans. Tin Lizzie and BetMGM Sportsbook is the place for the best sports betting experience in South Dakota. That's where I go every time to watch the big game, make a play, and enjoy some great food, great service, and some awesome 4K TVs. Tin Lizzie and the king of sportsbooks, BetMGM, where you can bet on college football and the NFL. Don't miss a second of the action. What game are you betting on? Make your play at Tin Lizzie and BetMGM Sportsbook, Main Street, Deadwood.
Live from the Anytime Auto Sales Service and Details Studio, sales, service, and recreation, this is Fox Sports Rapid City.
Well, we're off and running on a Monday. Weather's going to get interesting out there. It already is in some parts, so heads up. Thanks for being here. The Nate Brown Show getting you home tonight. Thought-provoking sports talk on Fox Sports Rapid City. Brian Noe's going to get us going. Fox Sports radio host. Countdown to kickoff every Sunday morning. Right here. Find him on Twitter at The Noe Show. And Brian Noe's in on The Nate Brown Show tonight. Brian, good to have you, man. How are you?
I'm great, Nate Brown. Now, I'm curious, before we get into it, man, just musically, what are you into when it comes to music? What's your go-to genre?
You know, I'm an 80s, 90s guy. I hate to break that to you, but I love 80s, 90s. Give me a little pop rock in there. I'm okay with it.
Little pop rock from the 80s and 90s. So yeah. Who's the go-to, like, band or like individual talent?
If you give me a little Tom Petty, throw in a little Phil Collins, throw in a little Boston. How about that?
Okay. Nice little trio right there.
Okay, I always have that featured on the show, Brian. You know that, okay? I'm going to serve up the goods for you. By the way, let's get into this. I started my show with a Broncos segment that I wanted to, you know, it's not that the Broncos are going anywhere. They lost again to the Chiefs. But yesterday showed me something, and here's where I'm sitting. They were down 27-0. They have backup O linemen, backup wide receivers. It's a mess. The Chiefs were laughing at them on the sideline. Travis Kelce was laughing at him when they were up 27-0. And I said, Russell Wilson, I think I'm going to give him a lot of credit yesterday for how he balled out, how he competed. It's all gone wrong. He gets 100 grading, runs it, throws three TDs. It's one of those things where he competed, and they're going nowhere. And I say, I'll take that Russell Wilson, that competitor, that leader, I'll take that all day over some of the other guys blaming and excusing, and you see Tom Brady yesterday blaming others for a 7-point performance. I'll take the Russell Wilson leadership all day, but what's your read on where the Broncos go?
Yeah, no, I'm with you, Nate. And really, when you stop and think about it big picture-wise, it's one of the strengths of the NFL, and it's one of the more beautiful things about the NFL, is the Broncos are one of many teams that are going nowhere fast this season. And they're still battling. You know, think about the Houston Texans yesterday, gave the Cowboys all they could handle. Think about the Rams with Baker Mayfield and beating the Raiders in comeback fashion. And those teams, their season is a wrap. And for the Texans, draft position is at stake. You know, if they win, they're jeopardizing potentially their first overall pick. So I think that's one of the strengths of the NFL, where you don't get this, hey, it's not in the cards for us, so let's just say screw it and get to the offseason healthy. They're still out there. Russell Wilson, when he tried to, he made the first down, was sniffing the goal line there. When he got hit, he was knocked out cold initially, and then he seemed to get his bearings. But the point is, it's really cool to see those guys go out and battle when they're on teams that, especially in Denver's case, had really high expectations on top of it. The Rams are the defending Super Bowl champions, you know?
Right.
And they
right.
were, what, 3-9 heading into Thursday Night Football. And they didn't say the heck with it. So I think that's really cool for teams typically to do just that.
Okay, I look at this and I say Patrick Mahomes threw three picks. Broncos defense is good. They were kind of getting beat up early on. They created some problems. What do you think about the Chiefs and just where they're at moving forward here? They have some chinks there, I think, in the armor.
Yeah, there are. But, man, welcome to the AFC, you know? When you start looking at the competition, the Chargers, they got up to 7-6, right? But they're three back of the Chiefs. And they're looking like they could be a playoff team. The Titans are a hot mess right now. Baltimore is down to their third-string quarterback. The Bengals, although they've won five straight, you've got T. Higgins and Tyler Boyd that are both nursing injuries. My Dolphins have lost a couple in a row. The Jets are trying to sneak into the playoffs. The Bills, I mean, it wasn't a work of art yesterday against the Jets, and they've had some defensive injuries. So, like, when you look at the competition, everybody's got warts. And I look at the Chiefs, and it's one of those things where because they're so talented, because they have a lot of things working in their favor, I think we tend to, and this is not a knock on you, Nate, I get it, I think we tend to look at the deficiencies more than we look at the strengths. It's kind of like the top overall quarterback prospect, and we're like, I don't know about the 10-yard out pattern that he throws, though. You know, we start to look at the deficiencies instead of the strengths, and I think that's the case with the Chiefs. I think we're probably going to do that with the Chiefs more than any of those other AFC teams.
Brian Nowon tonight, Fox Sports Radio's host, countdown to kickoff every Sunday here on the Nate Brown Show, talking Week 14. So I got to go to the Vikings. There's people that say this phrase. Well, see, we found out the Vikings are frauds. They were 10-2. They're frauds. They got beat up by the Lions. Las Vegas saw this coming. I don't say they're frauds. I think the offense is good. The defense is not even average. They're 32nd in total yards allowed, 32nd in passing yards allowed. Mike Zimmer didn't have a good defense the last 2 years either. But I'd look at it and say, with a defense like that, I just don't see him going deeper to the playoffs. They're divisional round, and I think that's it. Does that make you a fraud?
Right. No, I totally understand where you're coming from on that. And goodness, look at the rest of the NFC. You know, you've got the Eagles are 12-1. Fine. Then you've got Dallas and San Francisco that are both solid teams, but San Francisco with their quarterback issues, and then nobody else has more than 7 wins in the entire conference. That's it. There are 4 teams that, you know, they either are double-digit winning teams or the Niners, which are 9-4. Everybody else has not won more than 7 games, or 7.5 if you want to get technical with the Washington and Giants tie last week. But the point is, yeah, you can sit here and say the Vikings are, you know, kind of, they've got their holes, they've got their deficiencies, I don't believe in them to get to the Super Bowl. Okay, I totally understand that, but think of it this way, Nate. They're going to be a 2 seed most likely. And what happens if the Eagles lose in the divisional playoffs? I mean, the road to the Super Bowl would then go through Minnesota. Are they capable of winning one home playoff football game and then maybe being in a position where you're thinking about Championship Sunday in Minnesota? I think that the change, the tune is going to change real quickly if that's the case. Their defense stinks. I think I could throw for about 250 on them right now. But you it's like the 98 Vikings. Maybe they have to just out-offense you. And if things break their way and they get a couple of home playoff games instead of just one, you never know, man. The NFC is wide open this season.
Okay, I'm with you on that. I said that, Brian. I was like, hey, I think it's just a division around team. I don't think they're better than the Eagles and Cowboys, but I said weird things happen, and so you can't count out the Vikes that say they're frauds. I don't think they're a Super Bowl contender, but, and again, good enough offense. That defense is way, way off, and the secondary hasn't been addressed. Let's go to this. Baker Mayfield, you touched on it. That was the story of last week on Thursday Night Football. Is there any future for Baker Mayfield there? How do the Rams navigate Stafford, his future, up in the air?
Yeah, well, it really depends on Stafford. He's the guy until he says, you know, I think I'm done. You know, like, it's clearly Stafford over Baker Mayfield. We all know that. But there are rumors that maybe he walks away. Maybe Stafford and Sean McVay walk away. And then they might, without a first-round pick or a third-round pick or a fourth-round pick, right? Like, they might be like, well, hey, we've got Baker Mayfield here, and he's a former number one overall pick, so let's just roll with him for a little bit. If Stafford moves on with life away from the NFL, yeah, there might be a spot for Baker Mayfield there. And even if Stafford is back, that might be where Baker stays, just as the backup. That's probably a good spot for him, because Stafford has had a lot of injury issues, and if you're there in that spot, it's a lot better than what we saw earlier this season with whatever is the equivalent of the Carolina Panthers in 2023. You know, to start on a team like that, and you're lacking some of the support around you, I don't want to make it sound like he had no one to throw to. DJ Moore is really good, and they had Christian McCaffrey for a bit. But when you are thrown into a situation like that on a team that the outlook is very bleak in terms of winning a bunch of games, being the backup to Stafford, he might be nicked up for 4 or 5 games. You might get in there with Cooper Kupp, a healthy Cooper Kupp, and all of a sudden you're in a better position to show off your talents, and then you get a legitimate shot to start. So that might be where he is. He might be the backup to Stafford, assuming Stafford is back for another season.
Brian Noah on tonight here on the Nate Brown Show. Listen to him on Countdown to Kickoff Sunday mornings, getting you set for the NFL. I'll go to the Tom Brady situation here. He's been yelling at his teammates a lot. He's been frustrated a ton. I mean, this isn't new, but yesterday, again, 7 points on the board. It was a struggle against the number one defense in the league and the 49ers. Is Tom Brady, do you get the feeling, Brian, he's going to have another season after this?
I think so. That's my gut feeling, Nate. Yeah, I don't know the guy personally, but now that he's divorced, you know, like, what's he going to do? Is he either going to go straight to commentating, or hey, if things break the right way and the 49ers are knocking at his door and saying, hey, man, let's go win a bowl. Let's go win the whole thing here. What do you say? I don't know how he turns that down. Now, some of the throws that he's missed, certainly he's not in peak form, but I do think it's a trickle-down effect. If you put Tom Brady with the 49ers in a legitimate running game, that's what's missing with Tampa Bay. It's more so they can't run the ball than Tom Brady is just a shell of himself. That's not the case. He led a game-winning drive just the previous week against the Saints, so he can still get it done. He's missed a couple of throws that he typically doesn't, but that doesn't mean the guy is completely washed up. And if you put him in an offense with a legitimate running game, I have no doubt the guy can still be nasty. So, yeah, if an opportunity comes his way, I don't know that he's back with Tampa next year, but if it's with the 49ers, if it's with a legitimate shot to compete for a title, yeah, I think he would be back.
Yeah, I saw Jerry Jones this morning on his radio hit said, you know, I've been a proponent of this, and I want to bring it up again. We should get rid of a preseason game or two and add another regular season. We should go to 18 regular season games. Is that ever going to work? I mean, they went 17, so I say we go to 18?
Yeah, I think it's just a matter of time, Nate. It's amazing they're talking about this already. So, yeah, I think that it's inevitable we're going to get –
two bye weeks. I'm surprised they don't have two bye weeks yet, by the way, but I think we're going to get two bye weeks and have 18 regular season games. When ownership sees all those dollar signs and they can smooth talk to players and say, well, hey, there's going to be a bigger chunk of the pie for you guys too. What do you say? And we'll sweeten it with an extra bye week. How does that sound? Yeah, I think it's going to happen. I don't know when, but the if part, yeah, I think the answer is yes.
Okay.
Just a matter of time.
Okay, that's my question of the day. I want to get the fans' pulse on this. Brian, no, before I let you run, Fox Sports Radio national host, countdown to kickoff. Roughing the passer, there was another one last night. It looks like they're going to bring that up here in the offseason as, should we review this? I asked my audience a few weeks ago, should that be reviewable, roughing the passer? Should we take a second look? They said yes, overwhelmingly. Do you think that's going to happen?
I've always wanted to see a sky judge, Nate. And to me, it's one of these things, we got to find the middle ground between getting things right and keeping the game moving. You know, this is like the NBA. They got rid of those automatic reviews in the final 2 minutes because they're just reviewing way too much stuff. But if it is clear and obvious, like the Chris Jones sack against the Raiders a couple of weeks ago, where he's not landing with his full body weight. It was brought in for, like, Tony Siragusa against the Raiders in the playoffs when he's doing, like, a nesty body plunge on top of the quarterback and injuring Rich Gannon. Like, that's not what happened last night. That's not what happened with Chris Jones at all. So if a sky judge looks at that and can see immediately, okay, this is not a body weight type personal foul penalty, yeah, I want that to be overturned. And that goes for anything that's clear and obvious. That's the key. If you have to watch it 10 times, it's not clear and obvious, just keep it moving. But if you watch the replay one time and it's like, oh gosh, that quarterback just got clubbed in the head by the defensive end and somehow they missed it, that's a penalty, yeah, I would like a sky judge in there to fix the clear and obvious things.
Brian Noe tonight getting us going on a Monday, Fox Sports Radio's countdown to kickoff host. Always great on a Sunday. The Noe Show on Twitter here on the Nate Brown Show. Brian, thanks for coming on. I always appreciate it.
Real fast, Nate. Running Down a Dream.
Yes.
American Girl.
Yes.
Or Free Fallin'. Where do you go with Tom Petty right there?
I'll go Free Fallin'. Okay.
Okay. Yeah.
Now you know.
You can stand me up at the gates of hell, but I won't back down.
You know that. You know that. Thanks, buddy. I appreciate it.
See you, Nate.
Good stuff. Brian Noe kicking us off on a Monday here on the Nate Brown Show. Countdown to kickoff national host on Sunday morning on Fox Sports Radio. The Noe Show. Always like talking ball with him. So a couple of things here. Tom Brady has struggled. He has. I mean, inconsistent. And yelling at his teammates yesterday again. He's complaining and complaining and complaining. I'd rather take the leadership of the Russell Wilson side. Positive mindset. Yeah, he's struggling too. But I'd take that side of it, and the leadership side. And the Tom Brady side, it's starting to wear down Tampa Bay, I think. The bickering and complaining, and it's your fault. And Jerry, come on, we're all not playing good. We're not playing good. Is Tom Brady going to continue to play after this year? 45 years old. Is Tom Brady going to do it? People think they're serving it up to San Francisco. Well, that's where he wanted to be. That would be a homecoming, and it's a good team around him and the whole thing. Do you want Tom Brady coming in there? The 49ers passed on him before. They just passed on him. Shanahan passed on him before because he said he was kind of upset. I mean, can you imagine not having Michael Jordan come in? That was the Tom Brady quote. Can you imagine if you're a team and you didn't want Michael Jordan to come in? The difference is this isn't Tom Brady of old, I don't think, anymore. This is the Michael Jordan with the Washington Wizards. This isn't the Michael Jordan with the Chicago Bulls. That's the difference, right? So the 49ers, I'm not so sure they're going to sign up. Oh, yeah, Tom Brady, we got him. I'm not so sure on that. Everybody thinks, oh, that's a slam dunk, 45, 46 years old when he finishes out. I'm not so sure about that. By the way, I don't know if Brock Purdy's going to be this good and that whole thing, the rookie to Iowa State for the 49ers, but I'm not sure Tom Brady's like, oh, yeah, the 49ers are just waiting for Tom. You know, he's done with Tampa Bay. That team's just not good enough for him. I don't know if Tom's good enough anymore to make the big plays that he used to. He's made some clutch ones this year, but he's had some bad, bad games. Nobody really points that out. We find bad games for Kirk Cousins and other guys, but we don't find bad ones for Tom. It's everyone else's fault, right? Will Raggett's coming in next, Vikings writer for Sports Illustrated. I want to discuss where the Vikings are really at 10-3. Their defense is historically bad in the second level, the secondary. They're just getting torched. Can they somehow overcome it? Yesterday told me I don't think so. Will Raggett's in next.
Live callers, big-time interviews, and breaking sports news. This is the Nate Brown Show on Fox Sports Rapid City.
With home values rising in the Black Hills, a cash-out refinance loan from Black Hills Community Bank is a great choice. Thinking about home improvements or projects? Think about a cash-out refinance. Possibilities are endless. Consolidate your debt into one mortgage payment. Tap into the equity of your home with Black Hills Community Bank. Get started today using the online loan application at bhcbank.com or call to speak to a mortgage banker. Member FDIC Equal Housing Lender.
Hi, this is Cody Young at High Plains Physical Therapy and Aquatic Therapy Center. I started High Plains PT in 1999, and we've been providing personalized care in Rapid City to help our patients get back in action. Remember, you have a choice for who you go to see for physical therapy. With our state-of-the-art Aquatic Therapy Center, we are equipped to help you achieve your health goals. At High Plains, we'll give you the one-on-one treatment you deserve. We look forward to working with you at our new facility. To get started, visit highplainspt.com.
The holidays are here, and that means there's plenty for all of us to do. Shopping, gathering together, eating great food, spending quality time with friends and family, and donating time to give back. Renewal by Anderson would like to take a moment to thank the citizens in the Black Hills for their business in 2022. Renewal by Anderson has had the opportunity to work with many great customers throughout the state when installing their new windows and doors. No matter what holiday traditions you and your loved ones hold dear, Renewal by Anderson hopes this is your best season yet. They humbly thank all of their customers for their business, and they look forward to serving new and returning customers in 2023. From everyone at Renewal by Anderson, have a Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. Curious about all that Renewal by Anderson has to offer? Visit them on the web at rbarapidcity.com. That's rbarapidcity.com.
When it comes to protecting your home and your belongings, what works for your neighbor most likely won't work for you. Insurance is personal, and that's why the coverage specialists at Fisher Rounds & Associates work with you to tailor a policy that protects your family, home, auto, and other valuable possessions at the most reasonable cost possible. We sweat the small and the big stuff, so you don't have to. That's at your service, at your side. Fisher Rounds & Associates, with offices in Pierre, Mitchell, Rapid City, Sioux Falls, and Watertown.
Lofi's Holiday Sweepstakes is back. The Bakers of Country Hearts would like to put a little more jingle in your holiday this season by giving you a chance to win one of two $500 prizes or the grand prize of $1,000. Winners will each receive a check that can be used for travel, gifts, or just celebrating with family and friends, whatever makes their holiday more jolly. For complete rules and to enter for your chance to win, visit countryhearthbreads.com/sweeps.
Hi, this is Dan Patrick. Remember to catch me weekday mornings from 7 until 10 a.m. right here on 106.7 FM and 1150 AM Fox Sports Rapid City. And now, back to Rapid City Sports Talk Show, the Nate Brown Show.
Hey, welcome back in the Nate Brown Show, South Dakota Sports Talk Show on a Monday, Fox Sports Rapid City. We are live, 106.7 FM, 1150 AM. Bring us up right there, foxsportsrapidcity.com. If you get out of the radio range, you know, when it gets dark, you can't listen to the AM nearly as good. Okay, when it gets dark, that FCC rule, we got to turn down the AM, but you can find us there, foxsportsrapidcity.com. Live stream on your phone anywhere. Parker Gabriel's coming up, Broncos beat writer for the Denver Post. Some reaction on Russell Wilson's injury. Broncos aren't going anywhere. I know that. what's the next step here for Denver? You keep Russell Wilson playing here towards the end of the year with four games left. Get to Parker Gabriel, Denver Post. Will Raggetts is in tonight, Vikings writer, SI.com. Find him on Twitter, follow him, Vikings fans, at Will Raggetts. And he's here on the Nate Brown Show. Will, good to have you back on. How are you?
I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm doing good, man. So let's get into the Vikings here. I started my show with it. It's not a secret anymore. I was noticing it here 5-6 weeks ago. The defense is struggling, especially in the secondary. The style is bend but don't break with Ed Donatell. And now they're 32nd in yards allowed, 32nd in pass yards allowed. What is Kevin O'Connell going to do here? I know you're at the presser today. He says he's not going to make any defensive changes. What should happen here?
Well, let's be clear. He didn't say he's not going to make any defensive changes. He just said, I mean, he's not going to remove play calling duties from Ed Donatell. They're not going to fire Ed Donatell. There's 4 weeks left in the regular season, and they're about to win their division and be a top three seed. I know a lot of fans would probably want that to happen, but that realistically, that's not going to happen in season. And for now, at least, Donatell will continue calling plays. But O'Connell knows that things have to change. I mean, it just hasn't been good enough. The approach has kind of been pretty rigid. They haven't adjusted much, and it just isn't working right now. I mean, they're playing a lot of off coverage. They're not bringing much pressure, and the scheme just isn't being executed at a high level by these players right now. And they were missing Harrison Smith in Sunday's game. They've had a few other injuries, but I mean, those aren't excuses to for the numbers you just said. They're dead last in the league. They've given up over 400 yards in 5 straight games. And for a while, they were kind of making up for it with, like, the bend don't break stuff you mentioned, third down, red zone, takeaways, and sacks. They were coming up with some big plays, at least. So the overall, some of the advanced metrics, the EPA, things like that, were kind of held up by those plays. But that all went away against the Lions. They didn't have a sack. They didn't have a takeaway. And, yeah, it just looked way, way, way too easy for Jared Goff. So they got to make some adjustments here.
Okay, I want to ask you, Will, you've covered the Vikings here. They're 10-3. I say they're fine, meaning playoff-wise, and you said, I mean, they're probably going to be the number two seed. I mean, we'll see how this plays out. But I look at it and say the Lions are better, and I think people maybe overlook how much better the Lions are right now. What do you think about, I mean, yesterday wasn't a great loss, but the Lions aren't the Lions of old at all, right?
No, the Lions have been playing much better, and I said last week that this was not going to be an easy game for the Vikings by any means. I mean, I think people were surprised by the Vegas line with Detroit being favored, but that's a team that was 4-2 in their last 6, and those 2 losses were close losses against the Bills and the Dolphins. Like, they have legitimately been playing really well since they started 1-6, and I think they had some hard luck losses early in the season, including to the Vikings at U.S. Bank Stadium in Week 3, but yeah, it's a weird situation for the Vikings because they are probably going to clinch the division this week with either a win or a Lions loss, or at the very least, they'll do it in the next couple weeks. They have a good chance to still be the 2 seed, although the 49ers are going to push them for that, but they'll at least be the 3 seed. And yet, it's just, I don't know how confident anyone can really be in their ceiling. They're 10-3, the first 10-3 team to ever have a negative point differential. They didn't look great in this Lions game. They got blown out by the Cowboys and the Eagles earlier. So I think, like, Kirk Cousins' play and Justin Jefferson, those things give you confidence. But if things don't change with the defense, it's hard to imagine them having the ceiling to really make a run in the playoffs. They look like a team that has a much better shot of going home in the first round than making a run to the Super Bowl.
Yeah, I said that. I started my show with, I think they're a divisional round team, I think. Weird things can happen, so I'm not counting them out, but I don't think it's a Super Bowl-type year when earlier it kind of felt maybe this team was special, but the defense has really faltered. So what can they do on defense, Will? I'm asking you that because I look at the secondary. This has been an organizational thing. Mike Zimmer didn't have a great secondary the last 2 years here, 2020, 2021. They've missed on some draft picks. Some of the younger guys, they just aren't playing up to speed. They have the guys they have. What can they do?
Yeah, it's Kevin O'Connell said today, like, there are a lot of things on the table. And, you know, it's hard to pinpoint exactly what has gone wrong or exactly what they can do. I think kind of the obvious things would be sending more design pressure, because the easiest way to help out your secondary, help out the back end, is to put pressure on quarterbacks. And earlier this season, they were doing that fairly well. Ed Donatell likes to rush four and devote a lot of resources to coverage. And when Za'Darius Smith and Danielle Hunter and Dalvin Tomlinson, like, when those guys were having success in the four-man rush, that helped. And that just has kind of dried up. Za'Darius Smith had 9.5 sacks through 9 weeks. He hasn't had a sack in the last four games. Mm. Danielle Hunter has one in the last four games. Tomlinson was out for a little bit. So they need to figure out ways to get more pass rush. And if it's not going to come kind of organically with the four-man rush, then you got to send more pressure. And I know there's a risk-reward aspect to blitzing, but they have to find ways to send more pressure. And then maybe just play more press coverage, play more man coverage, mix that in, because they're just sitting in this off coverage, giving receivers cushion, and it just isn't working. Like, it really is not working right now. So they have 4 weeks left in the regular season, and this Colts team that they play on Saturday has been struggling pretty badly with Matt Ryan at quarterback.
Yeah.
And then you get a Giants team that has a winning record but hasn't been playing that well, and then rematches with the Packers and the Bears on the road. So they got to figure this out. It's getting down to crunch time, and before you know it, they're going to be lining up to play somebody in the wild card round, and you can't give up 450 yards and expect to win.
Okay, I'll ask you this. Justin Jefferson, through 46 career games, has the most receiving yards in NFL history. He's ahead of Odell Beckham and Randy Moss there. And Chris Carter was on a show, and Chris Carter said, Justin Jefferson's better than him and Randy Moss when it's all said and done. What do you think of that?
Yeah, I saw that. I think it is, I don't know. For now, that seems a little bit premature. I think from a pure talent perspective, he's right up there with somebody like Randy Moss. But, I mean, Randy Moss, even that maybe feels a little bit crazy to say, because Randy Moss is like one of the two or three most talented receivers ever. But it's a different era. It's a different game. It's a really pass-heavy era. And Justin Jefferson, the numbers are undeniable. I mean, he broke all these records with the first year, the first 2 years, first 3 years. He has a real chance over these final four games to get to 2,000 receiving yards, which would be the first time anyone's ever done that. You run out of things to say about the guy. Like, he's 23 years old, and he just, every week, basically, he seems to be unstoppable. And unless Kirk Cousins has time to throw, then there's really not that much you can do to limit Jefferson. And earlier this season against the Lions, he didn't have a big game. They made some adjustments, and he went out and had 223 yards, Vikings single-game record, and should have had more, because it was ruled that he stepped out of bounds.
Right.
And he didn't step out of bounds, it looks to me, at least, on the replay. So that was kind of unfortunate. Probably doesn't change the outcome of the game. The Vikings went on to score a touchdown like a minute later. But, yeah, Jefferson is unbelievable. I'll just say let's let him keep doing this for a little while longer before we put him above Randy Moss.
Yeah, that was high praise. Chris Carter said, yeah, he's better than me and Randy Moss. Justin Jefferson off the charts, though, is really, really good. Will Raggett's on tonight, SI.com, Vikings writer. Last quick one for you, four games left. Vikes are 10-3. What record do they end up with after these last four?
Yeah, I'll say I think they can get to 12 or 13 wins. I'll go 13-4.
Okay.
And that might seem optimistic for them to go 3-1 down the stretch, but it's hard for me to, looking at the schedule, it's kind of hard for me to see them losing two of those games. I think they'll win on Saturday against the Colts, because the Colts aren't very good. I don't think the Giants are very good at all. You talk about like the Vikings being fraudulent. I think the Giants got off to a very lucky start to win as many games as they did.
Right.
And both those games being at US Bank Stadium makes it kind of hard for me to see either being a loss, although when you're playing this poorly defensively, anything's possible. But, yeah, I mean, the Vikings are going to get back Christian Darrisaw this week, Harrison Smith, Garrett Bradbury as well. So I think that'll make a difference. I don't see them necessarily beating the Packers, but at Lambeau Field, but they certainly could, and it depends maybe on who the quarterback will be for Green Bay in that game. So I'll say they finish 13-4.
I like it. I like it. And I think it's feasible. The schedule's not that tough later on, but the Vikes got to get it figured out. I don't know what they can do defensively. We'll see what the adjustments they can make. Will Raggetts tonight, SI.com. Find him on Twitter at Will Raggetts. Follow him there, Vikings fans. Will, thanks for the time. I appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
I appreciate your time. Will Raggetts tonight, SI.com, Vikings writer, Sports Illustrated. Find him on Twitter at Will Raggetts, live from the Twin Cities. If you missed it, I said the Vikings aren't frauds. This is a good team. This is a bad secondary, okay? The secondary coverage, the scheme, and the players I don't think are great. I know Harrison Smith, I know Peterson, but my deal is Harrison Smith and Peterson aren't as good as they were, and the young guys are just, I think the Vikings are missing there on numerous young draft picks in the secondary. And it ends up being 32nd in passing yards allowed and 32nd in total yards allowed. They've got to make some adjustments somehow. It's not a fraudulent team at all. In my opinion, they're a good team. I don't know if that defense will get them to the special place, the special category. Dave Hollenbeck's in next tonight. He's the St. Thomas More head boys basketball coach. Back for another season, and Coach Hollenbeck has his guys off to a 3-0 start. They beat all these teams over in Wyoming. We'll talk Cavalier basketball with legendary Coach Hollenbeck next.
From high school to college to the pros, this is the Nate Brown Show on 106.7 FM and 1150 AM Fox Sports Rapid City.
Seeking a safe and comfortable assisted living home that provides high-quality care? Burr's Tender Care Assisted Living offers services in a home-style environment. Family-owned and operated, Eileen and Edgar Burr take special pride of their work to make their home your home. They provide transportation services for appointments, accept private pay, welcome married couples, and accept Title 19. They also have a full-time staff with an on-call registered nurse for your peace of mind. Burr's Tender Care Assisted Living in Spearfish. Openings available. Call 642-7963.
Here's your Fox Sports Rapid City forecast. A blizzard warning begins at midnight tonight and continues until 5 a.m. Thursday morning. A winter storm warning begins at 2 a.m. early tomorrow morning and continues until 5 a.m. Thursday morning. Overcast tonight with snow likely. Lows around 18. North winds 15 to 20 miles per hour. Cloudy tomorrow. Snow likely 22. That's your forecast on the Black Hills Sports Station, Fox Sports Rapid City. Currently, it's 23.
From the kennel to the coop, whatever the season, Fleet Farm has everything to keep your animals happy and healthy. From training your pup to sit season, to mastering those retrieval skills season. From clipping your horse for competition season, to keeping the backyard birds well-fed season. And of course, loving your pets like family season. There's a reason people say, if Fleet Farm doesn't have it, you don't need it. Because we have it all. Fleet Farm, built for real life.
We're all going somewhere. Going higher, faster, farther. Going in new directions, to new places. At Monument Health, we keep going so you can keep going. We're dedicated to advanced orthopedic care. With the latest innovations, technology, expertise, and treatment. So keep exploring. Keep making memories. Keep going with Monument Health as your partner. Learn more at monument.health/orthopedics.
Hey, it's Chris Broussard. Remember to catch the iCouple weeknights from 6 to 8 p.m. right here on Fox Sports Rapid City. And now, let's get back to Rapid City Sports Talk Show, The Nate Brown Show.
Hey, welcome back. South Dakota Sports Talk Show kicking off the week. It's going to be a wild one. It looks that way, right? Heads up. Already some school cancellations all over the place. We're having basketball games, you know, postponed, essentially, like the one we were going to cover tomorrow night, St. Thomas More Douglas. That one's getting postponed. And we'll see when we get that one going. Maybe the 22nd, we'll see. But we'll keep you posted on all the coverage here. Okay, let's get a little sports talk going on a Monday before we get smacked. We're going to get ear-holed by some of this stuff. So heads up, everybody. Parker Gabriel's coming up, Broncos beat writer for the Denver Post. We'll talk Broncos' reaction. It was interesting yesterday. They didn't mail it in at all. Battled, came up short. Where do the Broncos go from here? I had a listener tell me yesterday, hey, this doesn't mean Nathaniel Hackett's going to come back, right? Like, the Broncos getting close to the Chiefs and kind of not giving up on the season. I said, no, that's done. That's over. It's over, right? Just a few games left. We'll talk to Parker Gabriel coming up. Dave Hollenbeck's on tonight. St. Thomas More kicked off their season on the boys basketball side, went over to the Wyoming round robin over there, played Worland, Wyoming, Thunder Basin in Gillette, and the Campbell County Camels. Cavaliers come away 3-0. St. Thomas More boys basketball head coach Dave Hollenbeck on the show tonight. Coach, thanks for the time. How are you?
I'm doing good. Thanks for having me, Nate.
Well, I appreciate your time. So I look at your team. You lose three starters from last year's state tournament team. You guys fired up and win three games over in Wyoming. What did you think of the start overall?
Well, not too bad. You know, the first night I thought we struggled taking care of the basketball. Warland put a pretty good press on us, and we had 14 turnovers in the first half, so that was pretty troubling. But we were able to finish the second half. I think we had four or five in the second half and pull away from them. But and then on the second night against Thunder Basin, I thought the guys really competed well, and we beat a pretty solid team and finished well over at Campbell County. So overall, it was a good weekend for us.
When you look at that competition, Coach, I know it's out of state, it's hard to compare. What do you think of those teams that you played there compared to here?
You know, I think, you know, Thunder Basin is really hard to guard. They're athletic, and so, you know, I compare them to some of our top teams in Class A. You know, we're going to get, they're going to play Sioux Falls Christian here coming up over there in Mitchell, so. There'll be a good comparison there, and Campbell County's going over there too. I know Mitchell is going to be playing those two schools, so we'll get a little comparison on that deal. But yeah, they're very comparable. You know, they run a five out motion that's really hard to guard. They cut to the basket. They're able to put it on the floor, and they shoot the three really well. And in fact, you know, they'll put up a lot of threes throughout the game, so way more threes than stuff around the basket. So they run a unique system. They're hard to guard, and if they get the lead on you, there's no shot clock, so they can make it really tough for you.
St. Thomas More boys beat all three teams in Wyoming by about 20 in all those games. The Cavalier boys are 3-0. Dave Hollenbeck on the show tonight, head coach for St. Thomas More, 27th year coaching. You're back for more. I know you got a son playing still. You got younger son coming up. What have you taken away after 27 years when you get ready for a new season? What's your approach after 27 into it?
Well, we've got a lot of experience at starting these out. So, you know, I think the main thing is how much can you get done in the off season. You know, that's going to determine how good you're going to be, and or how competitive, and if you can get kids to buy in with the off season stuff, you know, that makes a big difference in your preparation and starting out each year.
Okay, I'll ask you about that because I talk about that on this show a lot. The buy in, the commitment. You say off season, you guys can't make these guys do stuff essentially, but you could say, hey, there's this. You can go and do this from the speed, agility, strength training to basketball and playing in some tournaments. How do you get the buy-in?
No, you know, we're basically, you're right. We can't make them do anything, and so we have to just provide the opportunities. And you know, if they want to take advantage of that, then, you know, you're setting pretty good. But we've been very fortunate to get kids to buy in over here. You know, we do a lot in the summers. We travel all over the country. You know, we played over 50 games this summer, so we got to see some good teams in a lot of different places. And I think you know, kids like to do that. They have fun playing. but it also gives us an opportunity to correct some things in their game. And the main thing is just to get them better. So that's what we're shooting for. And we have a lot of kids that do multiple sports, and I'm a big believer in if you're a baseball kid that's going to probably play college baseball and you're in my program, I'm a believer on a Saturday or Sunday, you should be in the batting cage or what have you. And same with my football guys, they should be throwing the football through a tire. So, we certainly allow our guys to do all sports, but, I kind of expect the same during their season, that they put some time in at the free throw line or getting some jump shots up.
Yeah, Dave Hollenbeck on tonight, St. Thomas More boys coach tonight before his practice. They beat some good Wyoming teams over there. Kick off the season, they won nearly all games by 20 points, big margin. I look at it, I say, what percentage, coach, do you have an estimate of percentage of guys that put in work in the off season, whether it's hoops, speed, weight training? What percentage of your players that contribute show up? We talking 90? 95?
I'd say around there, yeah, 90, maybe 85, 90. We've got some guys during football that don't quite make it, but otherwise, baseball is tough too here in Rapid City. They kind of corner the market on that deal during the summer, and that's an important piece, but we've got them coming in doing something, and most of them are able to get in. But there's a few of those programs around that don't want them doing anything, so which is unfortunate. I don't have a problem with kids doing other sports during my season, but for whatever reason, these other coaches don't see it that way.
Let me ask you about the season now. You're 3-0. The Douglas game tomorrow got postponed because of the weather coming in right now. So I look at the start here. What about your scoring this season? You're going to rely on defense. You always do. You want to hold teams in the 30s if you can. But how about your scoring? Your son's back. You got Euler back. Those are your only two starters. What's this team look like offensively?
Well, we've got a lot of work to do there, to be honest. We're not a real good perimeter shooting team. But one thing we do have is some guys that'll move the basketball. They work together, and we've got some guys now that can get to the basket, and that'll create quite a bit of basket pressure. And I think that's going to help us from the perimeter as time goes on, when we learn how to play together a little bit more. So I think we'll be fine there. It's not as potent as you would hope if you plan on winning a state title. You've got to be able to score and not just play defense. And my coach is doing an incredible job with our defense here, as you know, we're going to have to work on trying to find ways to score.
St. Thomas More is 3-0. They scored enough and played some good defense. Beat Worland, Wyoming, Thunder Basin over there. That's a good program. And Campbell County, Gillette Camels over this past weekend. Dave Hollenbeck on tonight, 27 years at St. Thomas More. 3-0 to start. Coach, thanks for the time. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Nate.
I appreciate it. Dave Hollenbeck on tonight, St. Thomas More boys basketball coach. Love following that program. They win a lot. They compete hard. They compete hard. Held Thunder Basin, Wyoming as a three-point shooting team to 38 points. 38 points. I mean, when you think about it, if you can hold teams in the 30s, you're going to win in high school boys basketball. End of story. If you held them into the 40s, you're usually going to win, okay? Usually. You get some production there, you get over 50 points, and that's kind of St. Thomas More's model. Even with some of these good offensive teams they've had, they hold you into the 30s, 40s. That's how they win. St. Thomas More with two starters back, off to a good start this year, 3-0 after the wins over in Wyoming. Into the drive at 5 tonight on a Monday. I want to go to this. This came out from the Washington Post today, and it said you have to have a bunch of money, essentially. You have to have money in order to be a good athlete as you work through the ranks. That's essentially the premise, is they looked at some of the kids that don't have the financial wherewithal to maybe play this sport or that sport, and they say those are the kids getting left behind. How many kids do you think in this country don't have enough money to experience sports? And what does that mean for athletes? That does that determine who we see as good athletes moving forward into high school? We'll discuss it next.
This is South Dakota's Sports Talk Show, The Nate Brown Show, on FoxSportsRapidCity.com and live on 106.7 FM and 1150 AM, Fox Sports Rapid City.
Hey, Cobbler and Raider fans, you can now show your school spirit and earn money for your booster club. It's easy to get your Raider or Cobbler custom-designed debit card today from Highmark Credit Union. Simply open a Highmark free basic checking account and get your Raider or Cobbler debit card. Plus, each swipe will earn money for your booster club. Show your school spirit and support the Raiders and Cobblers with a custom-designed debit card. Visit HighmarkFCU.com.
First Gold Gaming Resort finishes off 2022 with our biggest month of giveaways in history. Every weekend, count on winning your share of $8,600 in promo play we give away through hot seat drawings. Don't miss First Gold's lucky $7,000 cash drawings on Saturday night. And it all wraps up with our annual New Year's cash and promo play around-the-clock giveaway, December 30th through January 1st. Get contest details at firstgold.com. First Gold Gaming Resort, it's where Deadwood begins and the winning never ends.
Need tires? Danny Menholt Toyota will beat anyone's price on tires. Plus, give you 2-year road hazard coverage at no extra charge. And for a limited time, get up to $100 rebates on sets of 4 tires. Our experts help you get the right tires for your vehicle, and we meet or beat any price. Give you 2 years of road hazard coverage and up to a $100 rebate. That's how we roll. See us at Danny Menholt Toyota or justhowweroll.com.
KIMM Rapid City and K294BT Rapid City, the Black Hills Sports Station, 106.7 FM and 1150 AM, Fox Sports Rapid City.
Whether you run the race, make the catch, cast a line, pitch a tent, or just look good doing it, Shields Rapid City has your gear. From athletic clothing from your favorite team, cold weather gear to keep you warm, to the best camping selection this side of the Black Hills, and the most stylish and functional women's outerwear and footwear, Shields has the widest selection of the best brands in the business. So when you're ready to get out, get in the game, or get going, get to Shields. Shields, we're right there with you at Rushmore Crossing in Rapid City.
Great news. I just got the State Farm Personal Price Plan on our home and auto insurance.
You told our agent about my thing for romance novels?
No, you don't have to get that personal. Our agent just helped me choose affordable options to create a personalized price just for us.
Oh, sweet. Then you won't believe the love triangle Jen is in now.
Contact me, State Farm agent Scott Carlson, to create your personal price plan today.
Prices vary by state. Options selected by customer. Availability and eligibility may vary.
Hi, it's Colin Coward. Great to be in the Black Hills. Getting heard weekdays 10 to 1 on 106.7 FM and 1150 AM Fox Sports.
All right, welcome in on a Monday. It's going to be dicey out there weather-wise, so I hope you're ready. Be careful, everybody, as we kind of get into tonight, tomorrow, Wednesday. Keep your head on a swivel. Stay safe out there. Make sure you're doing everything carefully, okay? The Nate Brown Show on a Monday. Glad you're here. South Dakota Sports Talk Show. A lot of work to do tonight. The Drive at 5 brought to you by Summit Automotive Group. SummitAutoGRP.com. Start there when it comes to pre-owned vehicle. And I'll tell you, with the snow and the winter still ahead, take a look. Great selection. SUVs, four-wheel drives, trucks, SummitAutoGRP.com. It's hard to find the right pre-owned vehicle. Stacy and Matt have found them. Okay, the Summit difference, SummitAutoGRP.com. Start there on your phone. Parker Gabriel tonight, live from Denver. Broncos beat writer for the Denver Post. Reaction from Denver on tap. What's the latest with Russell Wilson? He got clocked last night in the near upset of the Chiefs. Sam Herter's in tonight, FCS playoffs. South Dakota State into the semis, hosting Montana State Saturday in Brookings. Sam Herter, Hero Sports FCS analyst, coming up. The Nate Brown Show, throwing out the question of the day. This is interesting to me. Let's run through the story first, and then I'll throw out the question of the day and see where you sit on this thing. Washington Post out with a big article today and they kind of follow a family's journey through the world of youth sports. And it's a family that doesn't have a ton of money. They have a daughter that's a pretty good basketball player. She played basketball and volleyball and softball. She's been asked to play in this AAU team and this travel team, and the family essentially can't afford it, okay? That's the piece on the family, and then they get into some of the numbers. And so I'm very interested in this from youth sports. I coach youth sports, have a great time trying to develop kids and have some fun and learn and improve and the whole thing. And I think there's some of this stuff that people, I think we kind of forget about, that everybody can't do the cost of this or the cost of that. I'm doing basketball, and it's a low cost, okay? That's what I love about it, by the way. It's a low cost, but maybe that low cost isn't low for some folks. Here's what the number is out of the story today. Over the past year, 29% of kids are doing travel teams. Okay? You think, well, is that a high number? That's the stat that comes out. The number of kids competing in travel sports, travel clubs, okay, soccer, softball, basketball, hockey, the list goes on. That's 29%. Okay? It's up to 29%. So, and like I said, some of you may think, oh, that's not a huge number. 29% are doing travel sports, so there could be a big chunk that's doing community-based sports and rec sports, right? Well, in the past year alone, that number has doubled. That used to be 14% just a year ago. 14% of kids were doing the travel sports piece just a year ago. It's up to 29% in a year. And so the piece is pointing out there's more the travel piece now instead of the community-based programs, essentially. And so who gets lost in the shuffle? Do kids get lost in the shuffle? Here's the number from Natalie Hummel. She's the executive director of this nonprofit called Every Kid Sports. Every Kid Sports, helping low-income families play sports and that whole thing. She says in their study, 6.8 million kids in this country are essentially barred from playing youth sports because of the financial cost. 6.8 million, she says, barred from playing sports because of the financial cost. And then she says, even if you don't buy that model, let's just go 50% of that, 3.5 million kids that aren't getting a chance to play sports because it's too expensive. So I have a question of the day. Things take money. I understand this too. Things take money. You're entering a tournament. You got to rent a gym space. You got to do all the things, right? Uniforms, whatever it is. So I think there's some folks that think, oh, the youth sports, everybody's getting rich on the youth sports. There's some folks that probably are. And then there's a youth sports model where, well, we're just trying to do, you know, cover the cost of this and this and have a low cost model and have kids play and the whole thing, like around here. I think there's some folks that get lost in everybody, it's a scam and everybody makes all this money. That does happen. I understand that. That does happen. But there are folks doing it right as well, trying to keep it low cost. I'm going to ask you this question. The piece in the Washington Post says kids get lost in the shuffle, so if you don't have money, then you're not even going to be an athlete by high school. That's essentially the premise of it. If you don't have money, your family doesn't, you're going to get lost from the economic side, the socioeconomic side, and then you don't get the chances later on because you bag it or whatever. Do you believe money is a major factor in determining which kids become the better athletes or are seen as the better athletes in high school? That's my question of the day. Deep thoughts on a Monday. Man, I need to try to take it easy on a Monday, but deep thoughts on a Monday. That's a question I have. Because of this, I read through this article today. It was interesting. It's really interesting. I think it's a little different here in Rapid City than other places, but we have some similarities around here too. From hockey to basketball to soccer to softball. I mean, yeah, everything like that. Do you believe money is a major factor in determining which kids become the athletes in high school? Do you think that's a major factor? That's my question. Let's go to the phones. Thanks for calling. You're live and you go ahead.
Hey, Nate, how are you?
Hey, I'm doing good. What do you think?
It depends on the sport. How much is a basketball? I mean, you can go on a playground. Most of these major cities have basketball, in the parks, basketball hoops all over the place. And we have some here. But, I've been to major cities, and there are courts all over the place. And same with, football. They have these 7-on-7s now in high school. These kids can, you don't need a fully equipped or 7-on-7, maybe a helmet, which you can get from the school.
Yeah,
I think football's
a little different. I think that the point is they say, well, if you're not on a team or not on this team, you're going to get lost because, well, hey, we noticed this team and we noticed this player and we know this family and we know that family. They think you're going to get lost if you're not in that picture early. I think that's what they're saying.
Well, I guarantee you, if you're a sprinter in track in high school and you're winning state titles in sprints, somebody will find you. Don't worry.
Yeah, yeah.
But, it depends. I would agree. Hockey, golf, tennis, where, you need a lot of times access to a country club. I mean, tennis courts, there are some, but I know particularly lacrosse and hockey are pretty expensive because of the equipment necessary that you have to, even to practice it, you have to have. So those two sports. In golf, you need a green fees are expensive.
So you're kind of meeting in the middle. You're saying, some of these athletes are going to be seen. All are going to get a chance into high school, but maybe some might fall off the radar if they don't have the pockets.
So, baseball is another sport. I don't think you need a lot of expensive, of equipment there. And there's maybe in some of the bigger cities, they don't have fields or the fields are in really poor condition. But I thought they've made an effort in the last few years in some of these major cities. Major League Baseball has pumped a lot of money into renovating some of these fields in some of these bigger cities. But I think the major sports, football, basketball, where, minority athletes, especially African Americans, seem to excel, I don't think you need a lot of money to excel. You can practice and get a football and, you're a receiver. You can find all kinds of guys willing to throw passes to you to work on your catching and.
No, I got you on that.
I think it's a little bit overrated.
All right.
What's your premise too much.
I appreciate
it. Have a good evening.
Yep, thanks, sir. I appreciate that. Thanks for getting in. What's the audience say here? What's the audience say on my Twitter poll today on the Nate Brown Show question of the day? Do you believe money is a major factor in determining which kids are seen and become the better athletes in high school? Do you believe money is a major factor? That's my question. I think it's a tough one. Even how I phrase that, is it a major factor? I think it's a factor, but I don't think it's the end of story. Well, I can't, go to this, 7-on-7, or I can't go to high school football practice. When it comes to high school sports, I know you want to get exposure early, but you're not made when you're a fourth grader. You are developing, yes, and it all helps, believe me. If you're playing this sport or that sport as a fourth grader, it'll all help. I believe in that. I get it. But it's not, we didn't play as a fourth grader, so we're going to be terrible now. Now we're not going to have a high school career. I'm not totally buying that. Is money a factor playing on this team and that team and having the opportunity? I believe it is. I don't know if it's the major factor. What do you say? 70% of you say money is key for developing athletes and seeing which kids get seen. 70%. 30% checking in saying, no, all will get a chance to become athletes in high school. All can get a chance. Listener text here, 720-1067, Barron's Wilson text line. Nate, absolutely, money plays a huge factor. The cost of club sports isn't something every family can afford, yet the experience gives kids that can participate an immense advantage later on. And I understand that. I understand that. I think it's a factor. I do. I don't know if it's a major we don't have money, so end of story. I think it's a factor. It has to be. One more call on this. Thanks for getting in. You're live, and you go ahead.
Hey, happy eve before the blizzard,
yes,
dude.
Yes, be careful. Be careful. What's up?
It's absolutely a major factor.
Why?
You look at all the... Well, because youth sports are business now more so than when I played. Okay?
Well, for sure. Same with me, yes.
And so I think in order for you to be seen, you need to go to this camp, that camp. And, you know, I know they have good camps here for basketball and football, and Chadron's probably a great place to go for football camp, and Tech's probably a great place to go for basketball camp. But if you're really serious, you're going to need to go somewhere else.
And you need money.
And yeah, right? They don't do it for free.
You know? So I think it's a factor. I really do.
I mean, I'm not saying it's right. I'm not agreeing with it. But I am saying that's the way it is.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's kind of unfair. You know, I mean, it's kind of crazy that we were at a tournament a few months ago, and these kids we played against, basically their parents at 9 and 10, 11-year-olds were saying, this is it. This is what we choose, is this sport. Yeah. And we have a special school so that they can go to practice and weight train and condition
and go to
school. And, you know, these people pay huge amount of dollars.
Right.
And I just kind of think, to what end? You know, I mean,
no,
how many Division One scholarships are out there,
right? Right. No, that's the misleading part. All right, man.
I think so.
Yeah.
Hey, be careful.
All right, you do the same. Thanks for getting in. I appreciate that. Okay, interesting stuff. We could discuss it more. Okay? Interesting stuff. Can't quite, you know, we'll see if we can get back to it. I got to get to Parker Gabriel. He's waiting in the wings from the Denver Post. What should we think about Russell Wilson the rest of the season? He got blasted yesterday. Concussion, lump on his head. He was competing. I love the way Russell played yesterday. When everybody hates him, he's down, people kick him. Russell played yesterday. I'll take that leader. I've stayed by Russell's side. A lot of people quick to bail. I'm with Russ. Where do the Broncos go after this injury yesterday? Parker Gabriel from the Denver Post next.
You're listening to the Nate Brown Show.
Before you buy, shop Gateway Autoplex. Are you looking to trade your vehicle and get ready for winter? Well, stop into the nicest pre-owned inventory of Fords, Lincolns, Dodges, Chevys, and save thousands. Hey, and Gateway's looking for some more inventory, so if you want to sell your car, truck, or SUV, stop on down for an offer today.
So for the best car buying experience in Rapid City or the best credit rebuilder program, stop down to 410 North Campbell Street or 123 Omaha. I'm Scott Hanna.
And I'm Adam Ring.
And nobody, I mean nobody,
beats a Gateway deal.
This holiday season, Ray at Quality Motors LLC and Quality Commercial Properties LLC at Samco Plaza would like to wish you and your family a Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. He would like to thank all of his customers for a great year and wishes you a happy and prosperous 2023. He's also grateful for the opportunity to be doing business in South Dakota and is looking forward to serving the Black Hills area for many years to come. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year from Quality Motors LLC and Quality Commercial Properties LLC at Samco Plaza.
Denny Menholt Rapid Chevrolet is looking for a few great folks to join our team. We have immediate openings for automotive techs and body shop techs. We offer a family-owned environment, state-of-the-art equipment and facilities, tool assistance, tuition reimbursement, training, paid vacation, 401k, health, dental, and vision insurance, and of course, a very competitive salary. If you're looking for a fresh start, apply in person at Denny Menholt Rapid Chevrolet or apply online at DennyMenholtRapidChevrolet.com under the Dealer Info Employment tab.
Live from the Anytime Auto Sales Service and Details Studio, sales, service, and recreation, this is Fox Sports Rapid City.
Hey, we're on the drive at 5 of the Nate Brown Show. Careful out there, everybody. I know some weather's moving in. Have you heard? Get your head on a swivel, folks. Now, we're tough, man. We're tougher than a $2 steak here in South Dakota. So just get ready. Be prepared. Be ready. The Nate Brown Show here on a Monday. Parker Gabriel on tonight. Broncos beat writer for the Denver Post. DenverPost.com for the coverage. Parker J. Gabriel on Twitter. Parker, good to have you on. How are you?
I'm doing great, Nate. How you doing? It sounds like you guys are going to get a blizzard, huh?
Yes, it does. Not good. You know how that goes, being there in Nebraska as you were. So the upper Midwest, we're going to get hit a little bit. Now you're in the banana belt, man. You guys in Denver, everybody thinks Denver's like snowy, snowy, snowy. It's actually not that bad, Parker.
No, it's like tropical. We just send the weather from the mountains, you know, up your way.
No, that's all right. I mean, essentially, if people don't know, it's usually not too bad in Denver. Can get hit a little bit, but okay, let me get into this. I started my show with it. Broncos, I know, are going nowhere. It's well documented. Russell Wilson's been struggling, but I've stayed with Russ. Every guest I've had on talking Broncos, I've said throughout the season, I think everything's gone wrong. The injuries are outrageous. I mean, and people say, well, injuries happen to everybody. Not like this. They have the most injured starters in the league. Right. And O-line, running back, wide receiver, and the scheme with Nathaniel Hackett, in my opinion, is just not working. Yet Russell Wilson yesterday, I felt, was his best game. Whether you want to take his stats away or not, competing and coming back in the face of boos and everybody kicks him, I thought Russell yesterday showed, is there some light here for Russell Wilson?
Yeah, I think there is. And I tend to agree with your assessment. I mean, he's not played well. There's been times where you scratch your head and wonder how a guy who's playing his 11th year in the NFL could, you know, make some of the mistakes or miss some of the things he's missed. And at the same time, you know, quarterbacks who have played in this offense for the first time, even really good ones, have struggled. Aaron Rodgers struggled in his first year under Matt LaFleur. Matt Ryan struggled in his first year playing in this particular system in Atlanta. And then they went on to have really good production in years after that. So that certainly doesn't guarantee that Russell Wilson is going to play at an elite level in the future, but I agree with you. I thought he was good on Sunday. They haven't scored a lot of points the last 4 weeks. That, like you say, they've got injuries all over the map, but he's played a little bit more efficiently the last 4 weeks. He's completing 67% of his passes over the last month. Most of his metrics are up in that time span, even though he's playing with, you know, a glorified practice squad group basically at this point. So I don't think it's all, you know, rosy for him going forward. I think they have a lot of things still to figure out, and he's got to play better than he has. But I do think that there's been sort of glimmers of hope, signs of progress, however you want to put it, over the last 2 weeks. And then now, you know, just as he maybe starts to find some of that rhythm, he suffers a concussion yesterday, and you know, we'll see. They're 3-10. We'll see how quickly, or if at all, you know, that he's able to clear protocol and get back on the field this year.
I'm going to ask you about that because he got popped, landed head first, had the lump on the head, was knocked out. I mean, it was vicious yesterday. But I'll just ask you about that play and really his play throughout the day. He ran for 57 yards his most this year. And I look at it and say, did he get some grit from and respect from his teammates, because everybody likes picking on him? Oh, half the team went to the birthday party. I don't know if he has the team. Did he get some respect from the guys yesterday competing when the team's going nowhere?
Well, I think so, Nate, but I also don't think that he needed to get it from his teammates. I mean, I think he already has it. He just, when you talk to guys in the locker room, like, of course, some of the stuff he does, you know, he's induced some cringeworthy moments, and the let's ride thing is funny when it's the off season. And then when you're losing games, you know, it's easy to pick on him, and it's the same. It's sort of the same thing, and the same thing, and the same thing. The high knees in the aisle, you know,
right,
of the plane going to London. Like, it's a funny thing when you. You know, you make the big pass play to KJ Hamler, and you go down and win that game at the last minute, and then you lose five games in a row after that, and it's not so humorous. But I think all along, any talk of Russell, you know, losing guys in the locker room or whatever, sort of been overblown. You talk to guys even privately, they really respect him because he works, you know. And there's all kinds of people in NFL locker rooms. There's guys that are just the nicest, most approachable people you can find, and there's guys that have huge egos, and there's guys that, you know, act one way off the field, and there's guys that act other ways off the field. And I think most of the time, if you're just your honest self in the locker room and guys know you and know who you are, you know, that counts for a lot more than what the outside world thinks about you. And so, you know, all that is to say, I think that he's had a lot of respect in their locker room all year long. Guys obviously are frustrated because they're losing and they're not scoring points. But I think, to me, like, that element of it is the least of Denver's worries. You know, they've got to figure out how to score touchdowns, not how to make sure the outside world likes Russell Wilson.
DenverPost.com, Broncos beat writer. It's Parker Gabriel live from Denver tonight on the Nate Brown Show. So he gets the concussion, and he may be out this week anyway. That's kind of how that usually works. But I'm saying, do you just have him sit out the rest of the year? I wonder where we sit at on that. I wonder what the approach is there.
Listen, I think just because of the nature of head injuries, that you have to at least consider it. I mean, I'm not a doctor, and I'm not privy to all of, you know, how he bounces back, whether it's over the next couple days or couple weeks or whatever. But to me, like, I just, when you look at it logically, they're 3-10. They're eliminated from the playoffs. They don't have a lot to play for other than just trying to sort of continue to make progress and all of that. And it is just not, like, you just have a hard time convincing me that with any elevated risk profile, it's worth putting him out there. And I'd say the same thing if it was the number three right guard or the kicker or whoever, right? I mean, head injuries are just nothing to mess around with, and we have learned enough about them over the course of time that the rest and recovery is the best way to get over them. And listen, he's got a lot of sway in the building. If he gets cleared and it just is a matter of, you know, the doctors say it's okay, what do you think? My guess is that he's going to want to play, and then he's going to push to. And then it just becomes the decision from, you know, the head coach and the general manager and the brass of if they're going to let him. And I asked Nathaniel Hackett that exact question today. Is there a scenario where you would shut him down even if he clears concussion protocol? And Nate basically just said he didn't want to get into that at this point. That's a conversation they can have, you know, as that sort of moment gets closer. You know, him, it doesn't, you know, there's nothing to do until he clears the protocol anyways. But I would imagine it's at least going to be on the table, even if they don't actually end up at the end of the day, you know, landing in that spot.
Yeah, something to watch, I think. Something to watch. Will Russell Wilson come back, a 3-10 team, with the struggles and the concussion he had yesterday? Parker Gabriel on tonight from the Denver Post, Broncos beat writer. Last one for you. I assume this seat is still really, really hot. I had somebody ask me yesterday, you know, the last couple of weeks, you know, maybe they've made some improvements. They've still lost. But does that mean Nathaniel Hackett's getting a little more respect and maybe we could make a run at it because he has all these injuries? Maybe it's not the coach's fault, but I'm not buying it on my side of it. Where's Nathaniel Hackett on the seat, hot seat?
Well, yeah, I mean, I think it's hot without a doubt. I mean, you know, they thought they were a playoff team at the beginning of the year, and now they're 3-10. I wonder how much. I know fans don't like using injuries as an excuse, and guys in the locker room haven't. You know, it's like they got to go find ways to win games, even when it's Jalen Virgil and Montrell Washington and Kendall Hinton out there at wide receiver, and a bunch of running backs who, you know, they're going to go in. They had a couple games like this a little earlier in the season. They're going to go into this game against Arizona this weekend like this. None of the running backs who are going to play for Denver against Arizona were on the roster in week four,
right?
Let alone in camp. You know, it's just been one of those years. I think that's going to count in the evaluation of Hackett. Is it going to save his job? I mean, most people don't think so. You know, it's not that common to go one and done in the NFL. I think there's 17 guys that it's happened to in the free agency era, which is, you know, the last 28 years. Denver's never done it with a full-time coach. But this is a unique situation, too, just in the sense that yes, George Payton is the general manager that hired him, you know, 11 months ago. The ownership group wasn't here. So a lot of it, I think part of the reason why, you know, it's just all speculation at this point, there's not a lot of solid reporting, is because it's a new ownership group, and we don't really know how they're going to run the team. We have no, you know, sort of book on them, on how they want to run an NFL franchise, whether it's, you know, you're going to give them 2 years and see if you can get healthier next year and use the injuries and the improvement as the reason why you give them another chance, or if it's, hey, look, there's a high standard, you didn't meet it, you know, we'll find somebody that will. So all I know is that the CEO, Greg Penner, told a small group of us in London back in October that they were going to hold everybody to a high standard and that they expected to win a bunch of games in the second half of the season. And now they're riding a 5-game losing streak into the final 4 weeks.
Parker Gabriel, great stuff tonight. DenverPost.com has worked there. Broncos beat writer, he's on Twitter, Parker J. Gabriel. Parker, good stuff. Thanks for the time.
Yeah, you bet. Anytime, Nate.
I appreciate it. Parker Gabriel on the Nate Brown Show. DenverPost.com, Broncos beat writer. Good stuff. Good to have Parker down there. He was covering the Huskers and now took over at the Denver Post. We've had Ryan O'Halloran on over the years. Parker Gabriel in now at the Denver Post. Find him on Twitter. Follow him if you're not, at Parker J. Gabriel here on the Nate Brown Show. The Hackett thing to me, it not just because I want it, it's over. Doesn't matter if, you know, well, slight improvement, they're still losing. They lost to the Raiders twice. That was a killer because the Raiders were reeling when they played them a second time. They were kind of reeling when they played them the first time, actually. And there's two factors. Those terrible losses, okay, and they've all added up. I understand the injuries now. It's a mess. But the fan base perception. The fan base didn't love Vance Joseph. They didn't hate him right away. The fan base didn't love Vic Fangio at all. They didn't hate him right away. There's hate, and I mean it's turning into apathy then, where are the Broncos fans going to be going to games, buying the stuff, and the money piece? I'm talking moving forward. The hay's in the barn this season, okay? But it's that scenario. It's the terrible losses, the game management, the I had to give up offensive play calling, I had to hire a game manager, and the fan base just can't take the PR side of bringing back Nathaniel Hackett. And that means the new ownership group will not do that. The PR has been lost. It's gone. And so Hackett is gone. End of story. Sam Herder's back on the program. Herosports.com. We got to talk FCS playoffs tonight. Saturday in Brookings, South Dakota State against Montana State. Let's break it down. And the Jacks win over Holy Cross. Was that a concern the way it went down? Sam Herder in next.
This is the Nate Brown Show.
Get away from it all in the great outdoors for lasting family memories with a new or pre-owned RV from Dakota Discount RV. We make your RV experience fun and easy by providing you with a quality recreational vehicle, competitive pricing, and professional sales and service. Our large inventory of fifth-wheelers, travel trailers, toy haulers, and live-in horse trailers allows us to save our customers thousands of dollars compared to most dealers. Stop by and see us at Dakota Discount RV, 3330 East Mall Drive across from Cabela's and on JB Road, Blackhawk.
Ho, 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 ho. Auto Value has once again teamed up with Toys for Tots to help deliver hope to less fortunate children this Christmas. Now through December 15th, you can drop off a new unwrapped toy or cash donation at any participating Auto Value parts store. Your toy or cash donation will not only help Santa, but also allow one more child to experience the magic of Christmas. On behalf of everyone at Auto Value and the North Pole, we thank you.
Looking for a great place for a pregame meal that really satisfies? Or maybe you want a place to take your all-star after the game. Or you're looking for a place to enjoy a delicious meal while watching your favorite team on the big screen TV. Valley Sports Bar and Grill has all the bases covered for all those things and more. Top-notch, friendly, and attentive service. Wall-to-wall big screen TVs with all the big games. And the absolute best wings in Rapid City. Valley Sports Bar. Make it your place. 1865 Valley Drive. Rapid City.
Live from the Anytime Auto Sales Service and Details Studio, sales, service, and recreation, this is Fox Sports Rapid City.
Welcome back into the Drive at 5 on a Monday on the Nate Brown Show, Fox Sports Rapid City. A reminder, if you can't catch all of the show live, great guests tonight across the board. Catch the Nate Brown Show podcast that'll be up tonight. Listen to it when you can at your own convenience. Download it where you download your favorite podcast. The Nate Brown Show podcast at Apple, Google, Amazon, Spotify. We're out there. The Nate Brown Show podcast. Download it. You've got us. Good stuff tonight on a Monday. Let's go to the FCS playoffs. South Dakota State hosting Montana State. Little rematch of the semifinals last year, but this time instead of being in Bozeman, it's going to be in Brookings. Will that make a difference? Jack's number one seed got by Holy Cross. Everybody looks at the final score. You'll say, oh, that was easy. It wasn't. I watched every play. Jack Rabbits had trouble with the quarterback, gave up a lot of yards on the ground. South Dakota State just better overall, and they got it done. Good second half from the Jacks. Sam Herter's in tonight. Let's break down the FCS semifinals. HeroSports.com, FCS analyst. Sam, good to have you back. How are you?
I'm doing good. Thanks for having me.
Okay, so I'll go to the, you know, here's what I say about it. Holy Cross comes in. They put a scare in the Jacks. I'm looking at that game, I'm going, I'm not really worried, but I started looking at how Sluka, that quarterback, was running and just creating. Sometimes you get in a close game, and he's the playmaker. It was a few drives away there from being like, this might be really, really dicey. Were you surprised how good Holy Cross was in Brookings?
Not too surprised, honestly. I've been pretty high on Holy Cross most of this year, and I kind of describe them as a team that is maybe overlooked just because they are from the Patriot League, but they were an experienced bunch with a good amount of depth, a lot of good experience. Recruiting classes the last few years have been really, really strong. They have some FBS level guys on their roster, and this is the same team that last year nearly beat Villanova, the CAA co-champ, last year in the second round, and all those guys came back this year, and so it was an experienced squad that was veteran. That has good playoff experience, and so I thought Holy Cross would probably stick in there for, probably two quarters. I didn't expect it to go into the fourth quarter, maybe like it did. I thought South Dakota State would pull away a little quicker, which is what they did, but maybe it took a bit longer than expected. And I just think, South Dakota State, overall has just better top end talent. And Tucker Kraft made a big play. Jackson Yaki made a big play with the ball in his hands. And in games like that, you just need your big-time players to make big-time plays and big-time moments, as they say. And South Coast State, I think, just kind of wore on Holy Cross a little bit and got some big plays in there as well for the Jacks to win.
Yeah, they did. I mean, I thought the Jacks were better up front, kind of grinded them down. Defensively, they made some big plays in the second half. Jackrabbits win somewhat comfortably when it was all said and done, but it was a game into the fourth quarter, midway through there. So now they go to Montana State. Now here's the thing, Sam. Holy Cross quarterback could run it, create, okay? Wasn't the best passer, but did a lot of damage. Montana State's quarterback, Tommy, they love him up there. They're going to run it. The difference is I think they're really physical. It's not just going to be creating plays. I mean, they're going to be designed to try and physical South Dakota State. Do you think Montana State can match up there up front with the Jacks?
Yeah, that's going to be the key. And I really like Montana State's offensive line this year. They are quite a bit different than last year's offensive line. It's basically a brand new look offensive line for Montana State. And last year they were a bit more power run game, run it between the tackles. Their offensive linemen last year were bigger. They were maulers, more downhill blockers. This year's Montana State offensive line, which is starting three sophomores, one freshman, and then I believe the fifth starter is a junior, so a really young offensive line. They are, you know, I don't want to say small, but, you know, relative to South Dakota State and North Dakota State, they are a bit smaller. You know, they kind of go 6'2", 6'3", 290 to 305 kind of across the board. So you're not seeing a bunch of 6'6", 310-pounders. But what Montana State is doing, they're doing a bit more of an outside zone running scheme where they get their offensive linemen out in space. And then they have, you know, whether it's, you know, their running backs or whether it is Sean Chambers or Tommy Malott, they really get those guys out on the perimeter. And so it will be a little bit of a different look as far as rushing the quarterbacks. It seemed like Matthew Sluka, the Holy Cross quarterback, they did do some designed runs for him. But for the most part, it kind of seemed like it was him deciding to take right off and run. You know, there's some passing plays there where he just, you know, took off and run. Montana State will do that a little bit. You know, Tommy Malott, if his first and second reads aren't there, he'll just tuck it and run. But for the most part, these are going to be designed quarterback runs that South Dakota State is going to see. They're going to design, you know, Sean Chambers and Tommy Malott to for them to go out and make some plays. And so, they're obviously going to see something in the quarterback run game that Holy Cross did, but at the same time, it is going to be a little bit of a different look.
Can Montana State stop South Dakota State? I think that's also a question in this. I just wonder, because the Jacks, well-balanced, they'll run it with Isaiah Davis, really pound you. Then they can throw it a little bit. We know that with some skill guys. Can Montana State stop South Dakota State?
I think they are better built to stop the run than defend the pass. You know, the defense has been shaky for a good part of this year for Montana State, although I think especially their last three games, they've definitely played their best defensive football. But all year, their run defense all year has been pretty good. It's been the passing game that they really struggled against, you know, especially Oregon State, Northern Arizona. You know, those games come to mind where they kind of got picked apart a little bit in the passing game. Eastern Washington is another one. And it seems like, you know, that zone or kind of the middle of the defense for Montana State where you can pick on them through the air between the linebackers and the safeties is maybe where they're most vulnerable. And so I do think Montana State is more built to stop the run. And so I think this is a, you know, potentially could be a big game for Tucker Kraft and Zach Hines, you know, kind of try to find some matchups on maybe some of the slot safeties or the outside linebackers where maybe they can, you know, get some plays down the middle of this defense that is, you know, like I said, more gettable through the air than on the ground.
Sam Herter's on tonight, breaking down the FCS semifinals. Jackrabbits hosting Montana State Saturday in Brookings. HeroSports.com FCS analyst. I'll go to the other side really quick. North Dakota State gets Incarnate Word because they knocked off Sacramento State. Some people say, oh, Sac State, they're too high of a seed, and that's what happens. Is Incarnate Word going to put up a challenge to the Bison?
Yeah, I think they can. UIW, you know, while statistically it might not show it, I do think they can be pretty good against the run. They're obviously not going to completely shut down NDSU, but, you know, I think they can at least maintain NDSU's rushing offense and not let them completely run wild like the Bison maybe did against Montana. And even last weekend, Samford, you know, held up a lot better than I think a lot of us expected physically in the run game against North Dakota State. And so I think UIW, not a great defense, but I think a good enough defense, which is, you know, all you need when you have an offense that can score in bunches. Lindsey Scott Jr. is the best offensive player in the FCS, in my opinion. And, you know, he's got a good arm. You know, he sticks in the pocket. He can make some throws that wow you. But I think what will really scare NDSU is his ability to move, his ability to escape, you know, pressure, make plays down the field with his legs. I think that's the type of quarterback that NDSU has struggled with in the past, just defending an offense that, you know, spreads you out with a lot of good receivers, has a quarterback that can also beat you with his legs on top of a running game that can threaten you. You know, a lot of people will talk about UIW and their passing attack, but they're top 15 in the FCS in running too. So, you know, if your safeties and linebackers are just dropping back in covers expecting pass, you know, they'll do a quarterback draw or a running back draw, and they'll pick up 15 yards on the ground in a hurry.
Is it Jack's Bison, Sam? Is that what you've got?
Yeah, I'm not sure
really?
Just yet. I think NDSU, you know, I think that will be a good game, but it's hard to pick against NDSU in the Fargo Dome, especially against, you know, maybe a more southern team. But at the same time, NDSU is down a lot of bodies and a lot of key injuries. And I think the Montana State-South Dakota State game is as close to a 50-50 game as you can ask for. So I think that's going to be a really close one.
Good stuff tonight. Wow, could be a good weekend, I'll tell you. FCS semifinals, Sam Herter on. Cover at herosports.com. National FCS analyst on Twitter at Sam Herter FCS. Sam, always good to have you. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, thank you.
I appreciate it. Sam Herter tonight breaking down the FCS semifinals. Jacks, Montana State in Brookings this weekend. One game away from the national title game. Sam Herter on tonight on the Nate Brown Show. That'll do it for us. Get ready for the snow. Be careful. We'll play it by ear as we move through the week. Okay? Stay safe. Stay warm. The Nate Brown Show podcast going up right now. Have a good night. The odd